People's Radio.
You're listening to Birmingham's Big Community FM.
You are in tune to 98.7 FM New Style Radio. Get ready for some of the hottest talk on radio. The On A Level talk show is on the air. Let your voice be heard. On A Level addresses issues that matter to you. Join Ankhobia and guests every Monday from 6 to 7pm. The next 60 minutes belongs to you.
Birmingham's number one community FM.
Until the lion learns to speak, the tales of hunting will always favor the hunter.
There is nothing wrong with feeling good about your history. Absolutely nothing wrong. In fact, if you look at other peoples in the world, they celebrate their history. And they push that history so hard that it becomes so much a part of the national culture. People don't even think of it. It's so interwoven in what they do.
The On A Level talk show. It's real.
Robin, thank you very much for coming to New Style Radio today and to do this interview with us.
Thanks for inviting me.
Okay, you've travelled all the way from London.
That's right, yes.
Okay, that's what I call dedication and commitment at the highest level. Thank you. Also in the studio, we have Nigel.
Just spent 2 weeks in Egypt, initially for a holiday, but also a bit of research into Egypt, what is now, I can truly say, brilliant past. Really, really good.
Well, did you enjoy yourself in Egypt?
Yeah, wonderful. All the Egyptian, purely positive.
We're glad to have you in the studio as well to share your experiences with us. I know also you're going to have a lot of questions to ask Robin. Now, Robin, let's start the discussion with yourself. Tell us, how did you come to be a scholar in African studies and world history?
What happened was, in 1990, I just finished university, where I was studying economics. I came into possession of a book by an African-American, Professor Chancellor Williams. The book was called The Destruction of Black Civilization. I read it, and the book was astounding, and I had to read it several times before the general message got through. Then I realized that black people really do have a history, and that history is not the slave trade, it's way, way, way before that. And I came to study black history with a gentleman called Femi Biko, who is probably the most important black scholar in Britain. And under Biko's tutelage, I saw what he was doing and thought, I could do that. Yeah, I could be a black studies tutor too.
And you've also written several books.
That's correct, yeah. The most important is the most recent. It's called When We Ruled, and it's out right now. And if people are interested, they just need to go into their local shop and ask their bookshop to order it.
Let's get started with our discussion. Today we're looking at the Nile Valley Civilization, Egypt to a lot of people, Kemet to others. Robin, tell us, where does the origin of ancient Egyptian civilization begin?
Even before there was an Egypt, we could look at what was going on in Africa many thousands of years. If we look at the origin and development of culture, the very first culture in the world started in Zaire, in a place called Ishango, where what was found were harpoon points proving that 90,000 years ago, Africans were engaged in a fishing culture. Then we see other evidence, 43,000 years ago, evidence from Swaziland, South Africa, Africans were engaged in mining. 25,000 years ago, evidence has been discovered that Africans were engaged in what we would now call arithmetic. A particular tool has been found with notches on it, and those notches show that Africans were engaged in counting. The number systems are engraved on that bone. If we're moving on 15,000 years ago in Kenya, we know that Africans were engaged in animal husbandry. And then by the time we get to 12,000 years, we know that Africans in Wadi Kubania, which is Western Egypt, were engaged in agriculture. So we can then trace the development of civilization from the lowest level of technology all the way up to the development of civilization. And then by the time we get to 5,900 BC, that takes us back perhaps, 8,000 years ago, we start seeing the beginnings of statecraft in what we now call Nubia. Nubia is basically the southern part of Egypt, the northern part of Sudan. And then by the time we get to 5,660 BC, the unification of Egypt, which then becomes Africa's second state and the second civilization in the world after Nubia.
After Nubia, that's very important because when most people think of Egypt, they tend to divorce it from the rest of Africa. You're putting it into a wider context to say this is related to Africa.
And it's important to understand that the oldest African dates for the beginnings of culture go all the way back to Ishango, where we're starting seeing evidence of, as I said, this fishing culture going back 90,000 years. So if you can see then the elements of fishing, mining, arithmetic, animal husbandry, and agriculture, all those are in place thousands of years before there was an Egypt. Egypt then comes after all of these things are in place.
These peoples, did they then go on to populate Egypt, or are we talking about a different race here? Are we talking about Africans still?
Indeed. If we're looking at the peopling of Egypt, the oldest skeletons there are, some of them go back 35,000 years, are of Africans. And all the way from 35,000 years, all the way up to the very, if you like, the civilization that becomes ancient Egypt, the Badarian civilization. One archaeologist excavated the Badarian civilization and pointed out that no crania fitted into any European series as late as the Badarian period.
You say no crania?
That means no skull found in Egypt up to the Badarian point, which is the point just before the civilization kicks off. None of them fitted into the European series.
Interesting.
And then when we get to dynastic Egypt, where we start in getting pharaohs, we know that all the population of Egypt wasn't black. You follow? That's known because it is known that the first Egyptian pharaoh, Namer, had to battle non-black people in the northern territories to unify the country. But we do know then that the non-black element was, if you like, considered enemies by the rest of the Egyptians, which is why Pharaoh Namer had to battle them. And this becomes a constant feature of Egyptian history.
Okay.
In the case of Namer, his portrait statue does exist. It's in central London. There's a place called the Petrie Museum, which is part of the University College London. His portrait statue exists. The catalogue number is UC15989, and the portrait looks just like Mike Tyson.
That's interesting. Very interesting indeed. I'm glad you touched upon the ethnicity there of the Egyptians. When most of us think of the Egyptians, we think they were white people with dark tans. Is this correct, whether we're looking at pre-dynastic Egypt or later? You know, are we talking about black people here or white people?
Yeah, the idea that the ancient Egyptians were white-skinned is nothing more than a modern European fantasy. Has no basis whatsoever in any historical documents. You can't find a single eyewitness description from the ancient period that says that. Essentially, what's going on here is that Egyptologists, when you get to work with Egyptologists, you get to see how they think.
Yeah.
And the problem that they have with Egypt is that there's a problem that they identify with it. They could imagine themselves walking down an ancient Egyptian street. They could imagine themselves being in an ancient Egyptian temple. And when you ask them about this, they will say, well, we're not really interested in race, we're just interested in how the people lived. That way they can put the race question aside. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Now, why that's not convincing is that the ancient Nubians had the same culture as the ancient Egyptians had. They had temples that looked just like the ancient Egyptian temples. And some of their temples, as we've seen, are actually older. Not many, but some, because their civilization is older. You ask those same Egyptologists, are they interested in ancient Nubia? They will tell you no, because it's common knowledge among Egyptologists that the ancient Nubians were black. Does that make sense? So they identify with Egypt. They wish the ancient Egyptians were their people, but unfortunately, the evidence is against them.
And having actually just arrived back from there and gone on a number of excursions, one of the questions I was so interested to ask was, what colour were the ancient Egyptians? And you started looking at their faces, and then there was a grimace initially, and then there was a deep look, and then you had varying answers from they were mixed race, they were white, and they were never black. There was nobody that actually came and told you that they were black. And I questioned, well, what continent are we in? And at some point you got to Africa. It was very interesting to see that a lot of people a lot of the actual people seemed to divorce Egypt from Africa. There wasn't that understanding, Egypt is in Africa.
Yeah.
There was that. It was very strange. And when you got to that point that it wanted the crux of the question, well, you're obviously from Arabia initially, you're Arabs, you didn't come till like 1600. So who were the people there before? And then you had those who were slightly more academic or had a greater understanding. Okay, the Romans and the Greeks. Okay, you realise that. Then who were before them? And then you had that, and we're not sure, we don't know kind of accent. But you have that thing that they knew. There's an understanding.
What I'd like to know, if it's clear to scholars that the ancient Nubians were African, black men and women, why isn't it clear that the ancient Egyptians were black?
Okay, this is what it's based on. Essentially, what's happened is that Egyptology is a discipline where the blind lead the blind. That's unfortunate, the problem. And most Egyptologists, again, if you start working with them, you see how they think. They're sheep. And genuine, honest scholarship, genuine, thoughtful scholarship is largely absent from them. And what you'll get them, people parroting things that are just ridiculous. Okay, now, what's happened is that when the very first Egyptologist, in the modern sense, came along, his name was Jean-François Champollion. He was the first person in modern Europe who could read the hieroglyphic script. And there was an Egyptian word which, with Egyptian words, we don't really know how they're vocalized, but the consonants are NHS, and it's believed that there's a vowel I. And some people pronounce that Nehesi, some people pronounce it Nahazi, some people pronounce it Nehusi. And this word, Champollion incorrectly translated to mean black people. And then based on this incorrect translation, somebody else found a document where Pharaoh Sinosret III had banned Nehesi or Nehusi or Nahasi from crossing the border from Nubia into Egypt. And this was then interpreted as the first racist act in history, banning of Negroes from entering Egypt. And then if you follow the logic of where that would go, that would mean then that Pharaoh Sinosret III was not a Negro. It would also mean then that the Egyptians of the 12th dynasty could not have been Negroes.
Yeah.
Now, what happened was is that that document has been reproduced continuously by Egyptologists who have since found out that the translation was wrong. Now, Champollion wasn't necessarily being a liar because he was the first person to do it. So if you make translations, some of what you're going to do is correct, some of it's going to need corrections. And that was one thing that needed corrections. And as people found out that that's not the Egyptian word for black, the Egyptian word for black was Kemet, spelled K-M-T. Same thing, we don't know whether it's pronounced Kemet or Kamet or Kimet, but we certainly know what the consonants are. Now, what happened was, this notion then that the Nubians were black, but the Egyptians weren't, that worked its way into Egyptology. And then Egyptologists being sheep just repeated it and repeated it. What they didn't do was get Pharaoh Sinosret III's portraits, which show him clearly to be a Negro. There's one such portrait in the British Museum. I've just taken some students to go and see it for themselves. What's more, the 12th dynasty would appear to have not even been Egyptian. The 12th dynasty would appear to have been of Nubian origins anyway. But of course, the Egyptologists don't even want to go into that arena. So in other words, it would appear that you've got a dynasty from Nubia had become the rulers of Egypt, banned fellow Nubians for political reasons from entering the country. That same document has been misinterpreted by sheep to give the impression that the Egyptians were one race and the Nubians were another.
One of the best trips we had was when we went to the Cairo Museum. Cairo Museum itself is astounding. You could easily spend a month there and wouldn't see everything. It's amazing. And there's a statue, and the statue can't be any bigger than about 30 centimetres. And it's on this little man, and his features are so black. His nose is broad, his lips are thick. And his name's Khafre, and he was the builder of the Great Pyramid of Giza. And anybody who's actually seen that statue can in no way deny this man is black. he is a black man, as black as you can get, and he was a builder of the Great Pyramid, the Giza.
I guess it's like when you look at the Sphinx, isn't it? And you see the...
You see him from the side portrait.
Yeah.
And he's...
Even though the nose is gone.
He don't need the nose. He's a black man. It's disheartening to feel that people can just lie with their eyes. It's amazing how people can be so indoctrinated with denial, but they can lie with their own eyes.
You could look at it on another side as well and say that, you know, people want to be like you so much, they will do anything to destroy your physical attributes or to take you out of history. They want to be like you so much, they want to emulate you, and it hurts them to know that they weren't the first ones to have created these great civilizations. So I guess there's a, you know, there's something that we can take from it. But in terms of scholarly debates, we know of the work of Sheikh Anta Diop, and he's played an important role in verifying the ethnicity of the ancient Egyptians. Robin, can you tell us a little bit about that?
Yeah, Professor Sheikh Anta Diop was a scholar from Senegal. And why he's important is that he wrote a book called Nation Negre et Culture, but the English came out as The African Origin of Civilization, Myth or Reality. That book came out in 1974, and because it was now in English, it attracted a very wide interest. In that book, Professor Diop presents essentially part of his doctorate thesis. And his doctorate thesis was not just that the ancient Egyptians were black Africans, but also that other African culture can be related to ancient Egypt, in much the same way that European culture is related to the ancient Greeks and the ancient Romans. Same idea. Now, what Diop presented was, first of all, he went through the various classical scholars. Now, the classical scholars are ancient Greeks, ancient Romans. And he presented 10 examples where they described the ancient Egyptians. And then if you go through some of the examples, there's an ancient European scholar called Herodotus, who was an ancient Greek scholar. He said the ancient Egyptians had black skins and woolly hair. Lucian says that the ancient Egyptians were too black, then describes them as having thick lips and bandy legs. Other scholars, Diodorus Siculus, suggested that the Egyptians actually descended from the people of what we would now call the Sudan. And when we examine our 10 scholars, they paint quite a detailed picture of what did the ancient Egyptians look like. Then Professor Diop went in search of positive proof, and what he did was he had access to a series of mummies that were excavated by a gentleman called Mariette. And the Mariette excavation mummies, Diop removed elements of mummy skin and had that skin examined. Essentially, what he was looking for was the evidence of a high quantity of melanin or the absence of a high quantity of melanin. That way we could work out, are we dealing with Negro skin or non-Negro skin? Diop suggested that all the mummies found at the Marietta excavations, all of them had Negro skin. The next thing then was UNESCO commissioned something called the General History of Africa. That took place in 1974. Now the big sticking point was going to be, where is ancient Egypt going to fit into this, these volumes, the General History of Africa? So they called a debate, and the debate was called the Cairo Symposium. And at that debate, two scholars presented a case that the ancient Egyptians were Africans, and 18 scholars presented a case that the ancient Egyptians were Europeans, Asians, non-Africans. The two scholars, Professor Sheikh Anta Diop and Theophila Benga, won the argument. And if you read the General History of Africa Volume 2, the debate is in there, and it's really, really funny. Just watching two people slaughter 18.
Must have been very embarrassing for them.
It's been so embarrassing that one would have expected that to be sort of common knowledge and someone to do a documentary about it and so on. But for obvious reasons, none of this has happened.
I guess that's our job to do.
Indeed.
Just to touch on this point lastly, before we go more into the history of the Egyptians and the civilizations that they and religions and philosophies that they created, why is it important for you, Robin, as a black British scholar, why is it important that the ethnicity of the ancient Egyptians is fully acknowledged?
Because the same argument used to deny black people their history in Egypt has been used to deny black people their history everywhere. There is not a single civilization in Africa, not even in South Africa, which is about the furthest you can imagine away from the Arab world, that European scholars unanimously agree was built by blacks. Even Great Zimbabwe, as far south as it was, as far away from European or Arab culture as it was. Most textbooks, and you can test this for yourself, if you look at all the writings on Great Zimbabwe from 1871 right up until now, at least 60% of that literature claims that black people didn't build Great Zimbabwe. You follow? And essentially, if you look at the arguments they've used against, it's the same ones that they've used against Egypt. So essentially, why it's important for black scholars to step correctly on the Egyptian question is because there is no civilization in Africa that Europeans unanimously agree, okay, let's give it to the blacks. They haven't done that anywhere. And it's the same tricks that they've been using over and over.
Nigel, you're a school teacher.
Yeah, primary school teacher.
Primary school teacher. Why is it important for you as a teacher? Why is it important that Caribbean children, African children, Black British children have a full understanding and knowledge of African cultures like ancient Egypt?
Unfortunately, we have a lot of white teachers, good meaning, and maybe some who are non-good meaning, who start Black history with slavery. Slavery is Black history, and obviously it's a part of our history, but it's not a major part of our history. We were Black before slavery, we were Black after slavery. Our history is Egypt, our best starting point, where we showed ourselves to be innovators is in Egypt. Our children need to know that we built the pyramids, we built the temples in Karnak, in Luxor. We started mathematics, we started astrology, we started music, we started writing. They need to know this because this will just empower them. There are so many negative examples of black culture and black people being bandied about in everyday life as just, this is who you are, this is what you are, and it's purely negative. These children need to know how much positive we've given to the world and what we're still giving to the world. It's fundamental. It needs to be taught. It needs to be taught correctly.
So we firmly established who the Egyptians were. But Robin, tell us a bit about the different dynasties that they created. And you may want to start with a definition for our listeners of what a dynasty is.
Okay, a dynasty is a line of kings that all belong to the same family. And if we divide up Egyptian history, the first six dynasties, Dynasty 1 to Dynasty 6, is what we call the Old Kingdom period. Now, I've suggested that a dynasty is where you've got a line of kings belonging to the same family. So, for example, Dynasty 1 has nine kings who belong to the same family. After the nine kings rule, we then get Dynasty 2, which has 12 kings belonging to the same family. After that, we have Dynasty 3, which has six kings belonging to the same family. And if you have the kings ruling father, son, or something like that, you can see that the length of time involved is actually a very long period. So the first three dynasties, we're talking about a time period of approximately 800 years.
800 years.
Indeed, just the first three dynasties, because you're getting this father-son thing happening. Does that make sense? Right now, the most important things that happened during these time periods. Okay, 1 to 6 is what we call the Old Kingdom. This is where, by the time we get to Dynasty 3, there is a very important pharaoh called Zosa. And he begins building the first complex that then becomes the first pyramid. And he did it by having one structure built on top of another one, a bit smaller, built on top of another one, a bit smaller. So eventually you get the pyramid shape. And that monument is called the Step Pyramid of Saqqara. Then we get to Dynasty 4, and then we get a pharaoh called Seneferu, who builds three pyramids, the greatest pyramid builder in history. Then after that, we get his son, Pharaoh Khufu. Pharaoh Khufu is the one that, when people talk about the Great Pyramid, that's the pyramid they're talking about. Then we have Pharaoh Khafra, which is the one that you've just mentioned, who built the second Great Pyramid. And then we have Menkaure, who built the third Great Pyramid, and so on. And during this period, we get...
Robin, can I stop you there? You say the third pyramid. What did you say his name was?
Menkaure.
Menkaure, because in some texts it's given as Senufu?
Seneferu.
Why is there a change in...
Okay, what it is, Seneferu is the first king of Dynasty 4, mm-hmm. followed by Khufu, followed by a son called Djedefra, who didn't build any pyramids, so we can forget him, followed by Khafra, which is the one you talked about, followed by Menkaure. So what you have then is the three pyramids built by Pharaoh Seneferu. These are not the pyramids that people go to see. When people say they've been to Egypt and they've been to see the pyramids, trust me, they didn't see Seneferu's pyramids. So the ones that everyone goes to is the pyramid field in Giza. And then the first one is Khufu, the second one is by Khafra, the third one's by Menkaure. Okay, so dynasty 1 to 6, that's your first good period. Then dynasty 7 to 10, things go pear-shaped. Internal decline, internal stupidity. And then we have the second influx of people from Asia. And during this period, because the defenses are down. Then we get what's called the Middle Kingdom period. The Middle Kingdom period is dynasties 11 and 12. This period is where the Egyptians are starting to think and act very, very much like modern people think and act today. So it's no longer building monuments for eternity. It's now building monuments for utility. So you get now them doing things like draining swamps, public works programs, building planned cities with mansions. One of the constructions is a construction called the Labyrinth, which had 3,000 rooms, 1,500 rooms below ground, 1,500 rooms above ground. We get this during the Middle Kingdom. So in other words, the way that we think today about luxury and living large, that's what they were doing then.
Would that have been built like an apartment complex for the average Egyptian?
Absolutely, yeah, yeah. And you can then see that elements of what we would now call modernism, that's where it kicks off, the Egyptian 11th and 12th dynasties, the period that we call the Middle Kingdom. Then Egypt goes into another period of decline. And during this period of decline, we get dynasties 13, 14, 15, 16, and 17. Dynasty 13 and 17 are indigenous. Dynasties 14, 15, and 16 are foreign. And there's an influx of people from Asia, and they take over, and they rule for a very long period of time.
When we say people from Asia, are we talking about Arabs, Indians, right? Who? What do these people look like?
They were probably Caucasians.
Yeah.
By Asia, I mean from Asia Minor.
Okay.
Now, strictly speaking, this notion of Arab doesn't really exist at this point, because the Arab ethnicity didn't exist at the points that we're talking. It's coming much, much later. But we can certainly say that they were from that part of the world, and they rule Egypt. There's a name that the Egyptians give them. They call them the Hyksos. And there is a lot of controversy about who these people were. There's even evidence that they may even have been the ancient Israelites. But whichever be the case, they rule Egypt for a long period of time. And they do so much damage in Egypt that Egypt stops being a purely African culture. It then becomes African and Asian during that period. Then we get the next great period, which is what was called the New Kingdom period, dynasties 18, 19, and 20. This is the period that, if you see a TV documentary on Egypt, this is the period that it will always be set in. This is the period where we get people like Tutankhamun, people like Nefertiti. In other words, it's the bit that most people know, if you like. But it must be remembered, even though the rulers were black, they weren't ruling a black society no more. They're ruling a very mixed society.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But certainly we get dynasty 18 to 20. Then we get another period of foolishness and another movement of people into Egypt. And then we get the final great period, which is dynasty 25 and 26. Dynasty 25 is not actually from Egypt, it's from Sudan. But they saw themselves, correctly, as related to the Old Kingdom Egyptians. And what they did was they brought back Old Kingdom culture. And they created a renaissance. A renaissance is where you look back in time and you think, I like the way we used to do things. I like the way we used to step. And then brought that back in the 25th dynasty. And one of the 25th dynasty pharaohs was so powerful that he didn't call himself Lord of the Two Lands like everybody else did. He called himself the Emperor of the World.
Wow.
Making it quite clear that as far as he's concerned, he runs things. And when we look at how much territory he ruled,
he was running things.
He was running things. His name was Pharaoh Taharqa. Some people call him Taharqa. And he's even mentioned in the Bible where he's called Tiharqa. Same person. And yeah, he kicked a lot of butt. So the 25th dynasty, then we get the 26th dynasty. The 26th dynasty is also black, but they're not indigenous. They're from Libya.
Okay.
And they continue this old way of doing things program. And then once that happens, that's the end. Egypt then falls to the Persians in 525 BC, Greeks in 332 BC, Romans in 30 BC, and then Arabs in 639 AD. And of course, the Arabs are still there, and they're still running that land.
And obviously claiming the history of Egypt as well, and milking it, I guess.
It depends on who you speak to. It's a shame that you've had the experience you've had. Other people that I've spoken to, you know, who have visited Egypt, they've come back with a very different perspective.
It's interesting because what you find is, obviously, you can't see me, but I'm very dark in complexion. And one thing that was always called towards me is Nubian. So there's obviously a historical understanding amongst the general population that Nubia has something to do with Egypt. But they seem to have this geographical perception that it's in the southern part, it's Aswan. If you're Nubian, you only come from a particular area called Aswan, and that's in the southern part of Egypt.
All right, can I come back on that? What you have is, depending on who you speak to, because the way that the Arabs divide up Egyptian history is they'll make it clear that before their period, 639 AD, they call that period classical Egypt, where you get the mosques going up, the Al-Azhar University, and so on. Then the period before that, they call ancient Egypt. And you will get some Arabs who will admit the truth, and they will admit that they don't like to use the term black, but they do like to use the term Nubian. And they'll say the early period is Nubian, the late period is Arab. And then they call one lot ancient Egypt and the other lot classical Egypt. But obviously those weren't the people you spoke to.
No.
Inspiration without information sometimes leads to superstition.
The Honor Level Talk Show. It's real.
I was very moved by Legrand's statement about the state of the black man in the world today. But that be simply a warning. It is not a prophecy. We have been in worse states, but we have survived. I am sure, as has happened in all the history of man, we will find an antidote. But it has taken longer, it is far more difficult to find an antidote to racism. The destruction that has occurred, the shattering of the psyche, is something extremely painful. And you see it all over the world, not only here in America. You go into Africa and you realize the distance, the remoteness from history, from a sense of what one was, what one is. And you have to become aware of the fact that one of the most frightening things, apart from any disadvantages we may suffer, one of the most frightening things we find in many of our young people is they have lost a sense of worth. They have lost a sense of seriousness. They've lost the sense of the capacity and potential that lie within them because they have been crushed far too soon by the parents of impotence and powerlessness. Only history can bring that back. You cannot look at the plane of the present time and recover that sense of power and worth. When I was a boy in my teens, I almost lost that. I was driven by a fierce rage because I had been told that as a Negro, I was only 10,000 years old. I was the last person to appear on earth. I knew no better. We did not know anything more than that. And that the Negro was incapable of adult intellectual development and that the cranial sutures of his brain closed down at an early age, arresting further development. I was 14 when I read that. I believed every word of it. I had absolutely no evidence to the contrary. And I was so frightened, I decided I have about 7 years left before my brain closed down. So I learned everything I could in that 7 years. It didn't work the same way with other young men. They stopped. When they learned those facts, they knew that they had limits. They put limits on themselves. They created prisons. That those words, that philosophy, that assumption, those notions created prisons within us so that they could never regenerate themselves. They could never resurrect themselves. They could never find a wholeness within themselves. That shattered world was absolute. That is not the case. We are extremely fortunate in that we have the men and the women who can find the pieces again. Even as Isis looked for the pieces of Osiris and bring about a new wholeness of the psyche so that we can start again and resurrect ourselves. Because that is the great message that came out of Africa.
The On A Level talk show with Ankhobia on New Style Radio 98.7.
Robin, did any of the groups coming into Egypt, conquering Egypt, invading Egypt, did they add to Egyptian culture? Did they bring anything new to Egypt?
Arguably, you could say that the Greeks did some things. Some of Egypt's oldest temples in the very far south of Egypt, at places like Esne and Dendera, the Greeks had rebuilt. And the rebuilt Greek monuments are very, very impressive. Moreover, the Greeks brought some architectural style to Egypt, in the sense being you start seeing columns that look like Greek columns. They call them Corinthian columns. And you notice that they're all over the Dendera and Esne temples. But for the plus that the Greeks brought, you then have to balance that against the minuses. And the most obvious minus is that the Greeks got their hands on Egyptian documents and then passed them off as their own. And this is the so-called era of Greek philosophy. And when we look at what's the substance of Greek philosophy, the idea that the basic elements that go into the building blocks of creation, earth, air, fire, and water, these ideas the Egyptians had locked down from at least the 5th dynasty, the pyramid text of Pharaoh Unas. And essentially, once that information got into Greek hands, they ran with it and they never stopped running with it.
And their ancestors are still running today.
Absolutely, yeah.
But it's also true, isn't it, that the ancient Egyptians taught the Greeks a lot of what they knew. That is, Greeks actually travelled. Greek scholars, Socrates, these kind of people travelled to Egypt to learn at the feet of Egyptians.
Yeah, and it's documented too. Two scholars let the cat out of the bag. One of them was Diodorus Siculus, who was one of the writers from antiquity, and the other one was Plutarch. And both scholars mention the Greeks that traveled to Egypt, and in the case of Diodorus Siculus, mentions those that even had plaques that they brought back as memoirs from their studies in Egypt. So consequently, when we look at so-called Greek philosophy, and we look at the so-called Greek philosophers, and some of the things that they were supposed to have said, you know, like one philosopher had this idea that everything created comes from air. Another one had this idea that everything created comes from water. And then when we look at the different elements, it's just different bits that they've lifted from the pyramid texts where that information was first theorized.
And it's amazing that the Greeks would say that they brought to the world philosophy, yet they were killing some of their philosophers for bringing into the country
foreign ideas. Yeah, I think you're talking about Socrates.
Yeah,
Socrates was charged with corrupting the minds of the miners, teaching foreign deities and so forth. Yeah, and then when we look at Socrates, the man, he didn't study in Egypt, but he studied under teachers who had. And then when we look at Socrates, the man, he stood by his principles and agreed to be, you know, executed. So in other words, he does come across as a man of some principle.
Yeah.
But it doesn't change the fact that what he taught, just like what all the others taught, they lifted from someplace else.
Well, we're going to talk a bit more later on about the legacy of Egypt and the legacy they've left to the world. Let's go a bit more into Egyptian culture now, just to give people an understanding of the kind of religion they had. How do these people live? How do they view themselves? How do they view the world? Whenever I've come across, or if I'm reading about Egyptian history, I always hear about Nile Valley civilization. I'm just kind of wondering how that kind of all fits together.
Okay, why people would say Nile Valley is that they don't just want to talk about Egypt, they want to talk about what else was going on in the Nile Valley. And the most important other thing that was going on is the lands to the south. The lands to the south are the lands that various people called Nubia, various people called Kush. And they also had a hand in what was going on. And as I said before, they shared the same type of culture. They worshipped the same sorts of deities and so forth. Okay, now, the Egyptian creation story is interesting for a whole host of reasons, because you've got this idea of two elements coming together, one male, one female, and it produces its opposite. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So when we look at the Egyptian creation story, one part of the story has two elements coming together, one male, one female, and they represent darkness. When they come together, the child produced, if you like, becomes light. Another thing is male and female representing boundlessness, and when they come together, we then get finiteness. Another element is a male and female representing nothingness, and when they come together, they produce things. And then another element of a male and female coming together representing the hidden. When they come together, the child represents visibility, the seen. Do you follow? And then from here, this idea of something coming into being, that is its opposite. People that have studied philosophy, they will call that dialecticism, this idea of two things coming together to produce its opposite. Well, it appears that the Egyptians have been saying that from back in the day. And now these elements then, things, finiteness, visibility, and light, these then become the elements that go on to create the next part of their belief system. Right? And one part of the belief system concerns a deity called Nun. Nun is your primeval water producing things. And then out of that story, we then get four elements coming out, which roughly tie up with earth, air, fire, and water. And out of those elements, we then get the creation of people, where we get Osiris and Isis, who are your first two people. Now, these ideas, they are philosophical, they are poetic, they are mythical, if you like, but these ideas were then the underpinning. Now, this idea that your four elements and then we get your first two people, Osiris and Isis, before anyone scoffs at that and says, but those ideas are primitive, you can see that every other religion has copied those idea of your first two people, except all they've done is just change the names.
Adam and Eve.
And they didn't change them very far, because Adam is actually copied from the Egyptian deity Atum. Atum, Adam. You follow me? Didn't change it too much either. You follow? So, and then when we look at the story of Osiris and Isis, there's also a story involving them producing a son, who miraculously was born on the 25th of December. That same son, Horus, disappears into the temple aged 12, and there are no records of what he was doing between the ages of 12 and the age of 30. He emerges from the temple at age 30 as a grown adult, where he's baptized in the River Nile by Anup, and then Anup is then called the Baptizer.
Kind of as Jesus was baptized by John the Baptist.
Well, indeed, I wasn't even going to mention Jesus, to be honest.
I just wanted to do that for our listeners to kind of really understand what's going on here.
Right. But, yeah. And then when we look at there's a fresco that the Egyptians like to use, and there's even one in the British Museum. And one of the frescoes is associated with a papyrus called the Papyrus of Ani. And what you see is Ani and his wife Tutu, they've gone up to Amenta. Amenta, Amen means hidden. Ta land, Amenta, the hidden land. What we would call heaven, or Muslims would call paradise, same concept. They went up to heaven, and what happens is there are 12 people, if you like, waiting in judgment of them. And when they're, you know, there, they have to have their heart weighed against a feather to see whether or not they've done wicked things or not. And there's even the reporter, Tehuti, writing down everything that they ever did. This is what's on the papyrus.
Yeah.
And then you have Horus taking Ani by the hand to meet his father. And what that symbolizes is that you cannot get to the father unless you get via the son. You have to go through the son to meet the father.
As the Book of John says.
Indeed. And then you have Osiris sitting on his throne in judgment of what's going to take place. And that's what's in the papyrus of Ani, which was buried with the Egyptians. And according to Sir E.A. Wallace Budge, that book was revised 4100 BC. It wasn't even written 4100 BC, it was revised 4100 BC, which gives us a picture of how old these ideas are.
So did the Egyptians then have a state religion? What you're talking about, was these kind of ideas form the basis of a state religion, or did they go through several different religions?
If you look at the evolution of Egypt, different deities predominate at different times.
By deities, you mean God?
Yeah, you could say gods, but here's the problem. If you say gods, it's almost like you're saying that they're, you know, primitives, you know, worshipping the gods. And when you read Egyptian records, they themselves always speak of the One. And they make it quite clear they are speaking about the One. So if people can get their head around that, we see certain, if you like, attributes of the deity predominating, and we can call these your deities. At some point you see Osiris, this is your deity of resurrection. He predominates at some points in the history. Amen predominates at other points. You know the Temple of Karnak? You've been to Karnak?
Can I just go there? Akhenaten. Wasn't he one of the more revolutionary pharaohs in that he tried to get rid of revise all that went before him and focus on just one god in terms of...
Or to be exact, one deity.
One deity.
Yeah, because even before him, everyone was still talking about the One. Mm. Yeah? Okay, Akhenaten comes in the middle of the 18th dynasty. In the 18th dynasty, the chief deity was Amen. So Karnak, you know the whole temple complexes? A lot of them are, you know, the temple of Amen. Or the Trinity, Amen, Mut, who's his wife, and then what do you have? A child, Khonsu. Yeah? So you have a monument to Amen, to Mut, and to Khonsu in Karnak.
Yeah.
Right, now what happened was the Karnak priesthood was corrupt. And just as we see problems of that going on throughout history, there was corruption going on then.
Yeah.
And Akhenaten essentially put his foot down and say, right, this is not going to run. And his strategy was to sidestep the Amen priesthood by coming up with a new, if you like, religious experience. And this is the worship of Aten. And the Aten symbol was the sun. And all of the symbols were banned. You know this idea of thou shalt have no other gods but... Right. Akhenaten was the first person to step in that kind of direction. So, okay, now how do we judge him? Most historians are very pro-Akhenaten, and they're pro him because they see him as a revolutionary, they see him as a radical, but there's the negative side, which you could say that once you sidestep the priesthood, the amount of power ending up in his personal hands has actually increased. So some people actually see him pretty much as a dictator. And then that argument has gone on and on and on. But you could read both sides into it.
I've actually seen a sculpture of Akhenaten, and it's marvellous. His face, he has the most extended lips I've ever seen. And
it's beautiful, isn't it?
It's amazing. And there's obviously a little piece written underneath it. And they say it was because it was an exaggerated depiction due to the form of art.
Yeah, the Amarna style. Yeah, and I'm pleased that you brought that up. And you've presented the most positive example of it, because there are some Egyptologists who will say that Akhenaten was deformed. Because he looked so African and you can't read anything else into it, they have to say that he was deformed, and they say that's the reason why he's got such an extraordinary look. And then if you look at Akhenaten's daughters,
they look exactly the same.
Right, so presumably they're deformed too. And that's the only way that's their get out clause. And again, that shows what happens when you've got Egyptologists trying to identify And then when they see somebody they can't identify with,
he's disabled.
Right, must be disabled.
Yeah, I even saw a documentary on it actually. They said that he was disabled.
Yeah, so yeah.
All right, okay, guys. Right, okay. So we're talking here about Egyptian philosophy and religion. How did the Egyptians actually view themselves? How did they see themselves in the world at that time?
They did have a superiority complex. They really did.
That sounds like black people.
Well, to be honest,
like Americans.
To be honest, yeah, you could just imagine
Nigerians
in particular.
Oh, okay.
Man. But I'm not dissing the Nigerian posse. I love the Nigerian posse. But you could just imagine that's how it would have gone down.
Yeah.
And the way that the Egyptians took the mick, especially with people from Asia, where Asia at the time, it has to be remembered, was a very mixed population. It's not like Asia Minor today, where nearly everybody's near white.
Yeah.
It was a very mixed population then. And some of the pharaohs, like Amenhotep III, married Asian wives and then made them junior wives. And these junior wives then had their own palace. But the palace was like, you've got your own palace, but you're then confined to it. You can't leave. You can't, you know, go on a walkies. Or if you do, you're with an escort. You follow me? And there are records of Asians writing to the pharaohs saying, you know, what's happened to my daughter that you've just married? And it was, well, soon come, we'll deal with it. And that kind of attitude where they just took the mick. And they also took the mick with the people from Nubia as well, right? Now, what happens is, of course, that then is then blown up by Egyptologists to pretend that them taking the mick with Nubia was racial. Mm. You follow me?
Well, you've got an example. If you go to the Cairo Museum, obviously, you've got artifacts from Tutankhamun's too. You've also got his chair, and underneath his chair, it's like a bench.
Yeah.
And on the bench, it says there's depictions of Nubians, and you've got the description of Tutankhamun scoffing that these people were lower than him and he had taken over the people, and they've got a depiction of them being very black in their features. You get the feeling that they'll now use this depiction of the blacks who Tutankhamun's feet are now on top of them as a representation. Well, Tutankhamun can't therefore be black because he's putting his feet upon the Nubians, which, if you understand the concept of black people can also fight against black people, it doesn't,
yeah.
It's not a matter of a black person and a white person, it's two black people just having a battle.
Mm-hmm. Well said. Yeah, in other words, it's very important that we get away from this idea that everything in Egypt was perfect. Man, there's a lot of stupidity going on, and I mean gross stupidity, but certainly they did have that concept. But we have to temper it, because the Egyptians did call the Sudan Ta-Neta, which basically means land of God. Now, that has to be understood, and this is one of the things that Egyptologists don't like mentioning. Africa. Africa. And another term that they use was Kent and Nefer, which basically means beautiful land of the south. And so consequently, you get on one hand Egyptian attitudes such as the ones you've described, where Tutankhamun is walking all over the people from Nubia. Akhenaten also had sandals where you've got Nubians underneath them. Follow me? So we get that on one hand, and then you also have them calling Nubia Ta-Neta, land of God.
Mm.
You follow? Now, why would they say this? This is because the Egyptians believed that all the deities, Osiris, Isis, Geb, Nut, Amen, they believed that all these deities came from the south. You follow? So consequently, they called Nubia Ta-Neta.
They also had a close relationship with Ethiopia, I understand, and that they referred to Ethiopia as their mother. Is that particularly true?
Yeah.
They sometimes refer to Egypt as being the daughter of Ethiopia.
I'll explain that. It's a misconception. It's not false, but it's misworked. Okay, what that is this. There's a tradition that has been established for about 200 years of using ancient Greek names to describe ancient African places.
Okay.
Now, how that tradition kicked off is because Herodotus was one of the first historians to write, whose books have survived, and he was writing in Greek. An African scholar called Manetho spelt out his history of Egypt, and he did it in Greek. You follow? So the Greeks sometimes used the term Ethiopia to refer to all of Africa. Sometimes they used the term Ethiopia to refer to all of Africa and a chunk of Asia, because there were black people there too. Sometimes they use the term Ethiopia to refer to one country in Africa, and that one country is Sudan. So when people say Ethiopia is the mother of Egypt and Egypt is the daughter of Ethiopia, they really mean Sudan is the mother of Egypt.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
And the country that we now call Ethiopia, which is next door, that was a part of it, but that wasn't where the energy was at. The energy was in the Sudan.
Reasoning Empowerment for the Community with Ankhobia on 98.7 News Style Radio.
No topic is out of bounds. If it's real to you, it's uncensored to us. The Honor Level Talk Show. It's real.
Alright, let's talk about deities, because for most of us, when we come to hear about Egypt, a lot of us, we get our information, our knowledge via the Bible, and it's often said, you know, the Egyptians were pagans, they worshipped many gods, they were evil people, they enslaved the Jews. But we always generally have a negative image, even coming from Hollywood, the image of Egypt is always a negative one. Looking at the deities, did the Egyptians worship many gods, or is it a case that they had the concept of the one god who had many attributes?
It's about interpretation. As my tutor, Dr. Femi Biko, says, it's a bit like using this term water. By water, do we mean one water, one drop? Do we mean a glass of water? Do we mean an ocean? And God is like that. So if someone says there's one god, somebody says, I disagree, there's a billion gods. Who's right and who's wrong? It's a bit like you can't have one god, you can't have like one water. It doesn't make sense. Yeah? So the question then is, did people see it as one, or did they see it as many? That's the question you're asking. And then when we look at Egyptian texts from the Book of the Dead, the phrase the one is repeated over and over. And this notion of the one, this is before Akhenaten. What Akhenaten did was to get rid of all the other images except one. You see the difference? Yeah? So the whole point then is that just as people accused the ancient Hindus of doing the same thing, worshipping many gods, the ancient Greeks of worshipping the many gods, if you were to ask an ancient Greek what they believed, the chances are they would have told you the same thing, the one. Now what's happened is it's really modern people having a superiority concept over ancient people.
Yeah.
When in reality, modern people, many of us haven't read our Bibles, if we were being honest, and we don't know how many gods are in the Bible. Does that make sense? So even when the Bible switches between God and Lord God, we've all spotted that, but most of us have never asked the question why.
Yeah.
We've all spotted the passage where it says, let us make man in our image, in our likeness. We've all seen that.
Who's the us?
Who's the us? Same question, same issue. So my view is this. If we're going to say the ancient Egyptians were pagans because they worshipped many gods, then we have to say the ancient Israelites were pagans because they worshipped many gods. Then we have to say the ancient Christians, in fact the modern Christians, are pagans. After all, what's this notion of a trinity? How can you have a god that's in three parts? And three men at that, which is a strange concept indeed. Then we have, I mean, on my way up here, I was reading an article in the Times, and someone was making a film about a Christian saint. And that film is going to talk about the saints' sexuality and so forth. And Christians are up in arms. But let's be quite clear, Catholics are up in arms. Because Catholics have ideas of saints.
Yeah.
You know, Saint Christopher, Saint George. Who are these people? They're gods too.
Yeah, yeah.
And you'll even get people praying to Saint Christopher, Saint George, Saint Andrew, and so on.
Yeah.
So my view is we either condemn the Egyptians and condemn everybody else, or we exonerate the Egyptians and exonerate everybody else. Is that, you know, see where I'm going with that?
Yeah, most certainly, most certainly. Did the Egyptians have female deities, or did they just focus on male deities?
Of course, a trinity is mother, father, child. Anything else is, let's put it bluntly, nonsense. Because you cannot have a child unless you've got male energy, female energy, child. That's how they symbolized it. And so you'll notice then on Egyptian temples, you'll see a portrait of a pharaoh, and next to the portrait will be the queen. Portrait of a male deity.
Just a sec, was ancient Egypt then a patriarchal society? Because having gone to the temple of Hatshepsut, and you noticed while I was reading some of the literature, she formed herself into a male. Because she
was taking over a male role. Mm-hmm. If you're a head of state, that's the role. Mm-hmm. But that doesn't mean that females didn't have important roles too. Do you follow me? Hatshepsut was queen before she became pharaoh.
Okay.
Yeah? As queen, she would not have been shown with the beard. Mm. As pharaoh, she's shown with the beard. You see the difference?
Yeah.
Yeah? But this idea of male, female, and then you notice that in modern Europe, when people are reading the news, they'll have a man presenting the news, a woman presenting the news, and everyone's thinking breakthrough for feminism. No, it's very, very ancient. Now, what happens is that the political structure of Egypt certainly was patriarchal, in the sense that it went from father to son, father to son. Yes, women ruled, and we can mention some of them, like Menith, Hatshepsut you've mentioned, Tawazret. These were women that ruled as pharaohs. Some ruled as queens, like Queen Taye and so on. But you also have that in Egyptian family life, women were dominant. And there's some very controversial scholarship that was done by a scholar called Robert Brifo, where he suggested that when men and women got married, the man agrees to obey the woman in all things. And Dr. Brifo then analyzed that to get hold of Egyptian marriage contracts. And yes, they do actually say that. Very controversial, because a lot of people don't want to go there. And of course, modern Egyptologists don't want to go there because it upsets what they're trying to identify with.
And of course, it upsets the present balance, which is a patriarchal worldview, patriarchal society that we have in the West.
Indeed, indeed. Yeah, in other words, there's other possibilities for how things could be. And, you know, one of the things about us learning our history is that it becomes models that we can take and discuss. Now, I've always said, what you don't do is you don't take something ancient and use it now. What you do is you take something ancient, look at which bits can work now, and add it to the stock of present knowledge.
Yeah.
Can I just mention, there's a book by Paul Grant, Blue Skies for Africans, and he writes a couple of very interesting chapters on how Africa itself is a matriarchal society in terms of women take a lead role in not only what we call the social aspects of family, but a political role as well. And it's only when we get to European civilizations where it's a patriarchal society and women are just thrown to the very bottom and it's seen as an economical burden. So you have the principles of when you get married, you give away your bride, and then and that you have to give a dowry of sort. It's because you're saying, oh, we now recognize that you've got the problem of having another woman. And so here's a little compensation, and I'm sorry. But that concept isn't seen in Africa because, well, Africa is very general, but in many African societies, because women are seen as having a very positive impact, a social impact at all levels.
Yeah. Robin, how do we go from a male, female trinity to an all-boy scout, this all-male trinity? How did that take place?
We'd have to then look at the origin development of Christianity.
Oh, okay.
Which would then get into a whole lot of hot water, which perhaps we'd better off not getting into right now.
Okay, but at least we can say that it began when Christianity came into being.
Mm-hmm.
Well, there you have it, folks. We're here talking about the great civilization called Egypt today, but then known as Kemet. In the studio, we have Robin Walker, and we also have Nigel. A lot to take in. It really is a lot to take in. Robin, how relevant do you think is the study of African, the study of Egyptian civilization? to black people living in Britain, to black people in the West. Are we just trying to make ourselves feel better? Because some people say we don't have a history. Are we trying to buy into something that wasn't there? What are we trying to do? Is there any relevance? Is it, you know, even important that we get into these kind of discussions?
Yes, I think it is important. First of all, let me state that there is nothing wrong with feeling good about your history. Absolutely nothing wrong. In fact, if you look at other peoples in the world, they celebrate their history. And they push that history so hard that it becomes so much a part of the national culture. People don't even think of it. It's so interwoven in what they do. And there's nothing wrong with us doing the same thing with our history. Now, for me, the whole reason for studying history, there's two basic reasons. The first is to provide role models for the present period. And the second is to make sure that a people know what they're capable of. In other words, if it's a situation that we look at Egyptian history and we can see that during the Fourth Dynasty, the Egyptians built a whole series of pyramids, all of whom are architectural masterpieces, all of whom are technological masterpieces, and show very, very advanced scientific and technological knowledge. That says to black people today, that's what black people today are capable of, because if we did it before, we can do it again. And it's not just with Egypt. When we look elsewhere in African history, we see equally extraordinary things. You know, like in Ethiopia, there's an underground city of churches that Africans drilled out of the ground. Again, we could do that before. We could do those sorts of things now. So it's about informing a people what they're capable of and providing models. And with those models, the role of our scholars and the role of our people engaged in debate is how much of this can be used today. As I've always said, you can never take something ancient and then bring it into the present. You then have to dust it off and see which bits will work, which bits won't work. But you can only have that discussion if you have a history to talk about. You can't have that discussion with no history.
Nigel, how important is it for you? You're a teacher working with young people. Mm. Is this relevant to them? Would they sitting on a class, learning about the greatness of African civilizations, would they be interested? And I'm talking particularly about black pupils now.
Definitely. Having obviously been brought up in a British educational system where you're not taught in any way, not in the minutest form, anything positive about your black history. You're taught about the Vikings, you're taught about the Tudors and the Stuarts, the boredom of being taught about people that don't look like you, don't sound like you, aren't you. It's horrible. So when you have so much positive imagery in terms of what black people did, it's going to empower the youth. It's going to empower every child. It has to empower them. Yeah? And it's just amazing having come from Egypt and just able to see such greatness and to know that your people did it. Yeah. It was mind-blowing. I'm not usually a person who's lost for words, but it was mind-blowing. And the sense of pride to know that you and your people conquered that and you did that, it's just amazing. And we need to be teaching it. We need to be teaching not just Egypt. You know, we need to be teaching about West Africa, South Africa, Central Africa. Our history is great and our history is vast. Yeah, it's not just Egypt. It's not just about Africa. It's about our impact on the world as well.
Because sometimes there's this view that when you study about African history, the main focus seems to be on Egypt. Mm. And people think, well, you're focusing on Egypt because Egypt was the only civilization, or what was the highest of all African civilizations. How true is that, Robin?
It contains some truth, but as ever, you have to then pull out which bits work and which bits don't work.
Yeah.
When we use Egypt's true chronology, we get the first dynasty date of 5660 BC for the very first king. And if we look at the beginnings of Egyptian history, 5660 BC, all the way up to the Persian period of 525 BC, that means that things were going on for 5,000 years. No state lasts for 5,000 years. You can't point to any other civilization where there's 5,000 years of continuous history.
That's amazing. 5,000 years. That's like, I can't even begin to imagine it in my mind.
And what's happened is, you see, most of us, when we think of, say, English history, and you go back to the very first English king, what I understand is Engelbert of Wessex.
Somebody like that. I wasn't paying attention at that point.
All right, we're going back something like 1,100 years. 1,100 years. Now, 1,100 years is a lot. It's an achievement. But compared against something that's 5,000 years, it's nothing. Mm-hmm. Yeah? And if you can hold your ethnicity together, your language together, your culture together for that amount of time, that's an extraordinary achievement. And that's why everybody studies Egypt. So if you go to somewhere like Russia, there'll be Egyptological societies. You go to Germany, there'll be Egyptological societies. Britain will have Egyptological societies, because everyone wants to know, how did they pull that off?
Yeah.
Now, that's why people rate the Egyptians so highly. But a study of African history, if we look at medieval Nubia, which is Nubia from the period of about 500 AD up to about 1300 AD, that civilization appears, from my research, to have been the most sophisticated that black people ever did. This was a civilization of churches, cathedrals, monasteries, a civilization where even in villages, people had sanitary systems, hot and cold running water, and so on.
Hot and cold running water?
Absolutely, yes. I've got the quote. It's an archaeologist report where they said bathroom, and they put in brackets, with water heating installation and something else. Yeah.
British gas up there.
Well, indeed. And if you consider this was early medieval period, that's what we were saying. Archives have been found of the medieval Nubian civilization, where some of the documents were found to have been in an old African script called Meroitic. Some of the documents were found to be in Old Nubian, which is another script. Some of the documents were found to be in Coptic. Some were found to be in Arabic. Some were found to be in Greek. Some were found to be in Turkish. And some were found to be in Greek Creole. Now, what does that mean? That means that you had archivists, some of whom could read 7 different languages. Right, so I believe that sets the standard.
Yeah,
because who else is going to top that?
In your book, you mention that there are parts of Africa where families have their own particular libraries of thousands of books. Where exactly were you?
Yeah, that's West Africa.
West Africa.
The example I've just given from East Africa, Nubia, is what archaeologists have dug up. They dug it up at a site called Kazir Ibrim, where they found this archive. In West Africa, the continuity between then and now is more there, in the sense being that in Nubia, the old cathedrals and so on, they're ruins. They kick butt, they're impressive, but they're ruins. In West Africa, the old mosques and so on, they're alive. And so you can go to West Africa and see these medieval buildings still standing. And people still use them, people still pray in them. Similarly as well, the sorts of houses that people had in West Africa, the ones they had in medieval times, are the ones they have now. There are exceptions, there's modern stuff as well, but the ancient is still there. And that continuity, then, is why you end up with people having books that date back hundreds of years to the time of the University of Timbuktu and so on. And you're right, we're talking manuscripts running, in some cases, into the hundreds of thousands. Timbuktu is believed to have 700,000 medieval manuscripts still in place, still intact.
Where is Timbuktu?
It's in Mali, West Africa.
You talk about medieval Africa. What was happening in Europe at the time?
Similar things, but not the same scholarly connection. Timbuktu, Radio 3 did a documentary 1 week ago called Timbuktu, the Center of the World. And they made it quite clear just exactly what Timbuktu was saying. Michael Palin did a documentary called Sahara, where he talked about the mathematicians of Timbuktu had worked out that the Earth was not the center of the universe, the sun was, and the elliptical orbit of the planets around the sun. And Michael Palin suggested that it took Europe 150 to 200 years to catch up with where the African scientists were at. And he specifically mentioned that when Copernicus made the same calculations 150 to 200 years later, he got a very poor reception in Europe because people were not prepared to hear that.
the general perception is that the Europeans brought civilization to the world, that the world was in darkness until the white man, until the European man came upon the scene.
But yeah, let me answer
that.
From
what you're saying, this doesn't seem to be quite true.
No. What happens is that where some people present stuff that contains truth, but essentially truth has been hidden in amongst a much bigger lie. And that's what's happened here. All right, let me explain. Medieval Europe had a lot going on. Make no mistake, the cathedral age of medieval Europe, the cathedrals that they built in France and so on, like Chartres Cathedral, Notre Dame, very, very impressive monuments. Monuments that kick butt, make no mistake. And while those monuments were going up in Europe, we were building things like the Great Mosque of Jenne in West Africa. We were building things like the Lalibela churches in Ethiopia, the underground city of churches. We were building things like Great Zimbabwe, which is that large fortress. You follow me? So there's certain things that you can show that are comparable. But when it comes to scholarly tradition, Europe can't point to anything in the medieval period that resembled Timbuktu. They really can't. You'll get scholars that will try and style it out, but styling it out is all that they can come with. You follow? Right, now, what happens is that whereas Europe continues to advance from the medieval period, we start going downhill from about the year 1600. And that downhill, we can trace it to one thing, the slave trade. And so, by the time we get to the year 1900, Europe is very advanced, and we've gone very far backward. And so if you look at Africa in the year 1900, there would have been pockets of civilization surrounded by a lot of poverty, a lot of squalor, and a lot of ignorance. Do you follow me? But what most people don't do is to trace the squalor, the backwardness, and the ignorance to its cause. What happens once you've been slave raided?
Can the same be said of Egypt, in that Egypt was invaded? Egypt,
absolutely.
That great civilization
absolutely
fell. How does this tie into
if you look
the
at
rest
the,
of Africa?
Absolutely. If you look at the modern day people of Egypt, the real people in Egypt who are descended from the Egyptians are the Nubians.
Hmm.
Yeah. And I mean, perhaps you can tell me, you know, how were they living? They weren't living large.
They were living not large at all. We were taken along the Nile. We were shown an island where they were pretty much just thrown onto an island. Their accommodation was pretty much poor. Their clothing disheveled. They looked in a bit of a sorry state. One of the person that was sailing our boat off Luca down, a Nubian. You recognise him physically as being a black person, but he looked a bit downtrodden. The impetus wasn't there.
And essentially, that's where we've been. And the beginnings of it kicked in with the slave trade. Because what happens is, once you've been slave raided, your ability to establish settled communities, where people are living, if you like, in the open, you can't really do that. Because if you're slave raided, people are going to get caught. So people end up living in more secluded places, like retreating to the bush. After a while, bush culture becomes your culture. You'll end up with some people retreating to the swamps, and after a while, swamp culture becomes your culture. And so a people who were living in a civilized state in the 15th century and earlier periods could end up living in a savage state by the 18th and 19th centuries. Do you follow?
Yeah.
And what the Europeans won't do is to trace how their impact created that, because they will pretend that the before didn't exist.
Yeah.
Can you say something a bit about the slave trade in terms of Arabs and how they took part in it? What was the history behind that?
Yeah, if you like, if you were to trace the development of slave trading in Africa, they were the second big story. The first big story was the Romans. The Romans conquered North Africa. They began their conquest in 146 BC, once they destroyed Carthage. And then they continued that conquest right up until 30 BC, when they seized Egypt. And then all of North Africa was now under their rule. Now, those North Africans at that period, we're not talking Arabs because the Arabs weren't there yet. They were black, they were our people. Well, then the slaves of the Romans. And then once the Roman power weakened, presumably some of those Africans thought they were going to be free people again. And then they were then swamped by the Arab invasion, 639 AD. And if we want to see how the Arabs conquered North Africa, just look at what they're doing right now in Darfur.
The reason I'm mentioning that is because I have quite a few friends who have converted to Islam, and one of the things they say is that Christianity enslaved black people.
True, but then...
But also, I try to say, well, Islam enslaved quite a few as well.
Absolutely. Yeah. But what our response to that has got to be is knowledge. Mm. And the knowledge is this. Yes, Christianity was used as a tool of enslavers. Mm-hmm. Make no mistake, Islam was also used as a tool of enslavers. But those religions didn't originally belong to the people who have it today. Mm-hmm. In other words, we had a hand in the development of both religions.
You're tuned to On a Level with Ankhobia on 98.7 FM, New Style Radio. This is Muta Baruka Ire.
As Professor John Henrik Clark said, it's up to us, if we want to, because again, it's one of those debates we must have, if we want to turn those religions into the decent religions they could have been, rather than to what they've become. In other words, I'm not prepared to hand over Christianity and Islam to other peoples and say they invented it, where they partly did, but so did we.
So are you talking about Africanization of those religions?
Indeed. So those religions can be the decent religions that their founders, you know, intended, you know?
Yes, indeed, that they intended them to be.
Okay, so to come back to the point then, which was Europe being advanced and us being primitive.
Yeah.
In the 19th century, there was truth in that. But can you see that there's a bigger truth that people have forgotten?
Yeah.
In the 20th century, again, same thing. Yeah, during the period that Africa was colonized, Africans were pushed very, very low down the ladder. And it wasn't just South Africa, it was all over Africa. You follow me? And just to give some idea of what I'm talking about, in places like Libya, it's believed that in the 1920s, the Italians wiped out one third of their entire population. Now, again, most of us are not aware that when colonization took place, it wasn't this, let's introduce the natives to Christianity. No, it was associated with atrocity after atrocity. You follow me?
Yeah, yeah.
And then what happens is, once people are facing atrocities, culture falls even further.
And when you talk about one third, we're talking about millions or thousands of people dying?
The population of Libya is believed to have been about a million. So okay. You're going to work out what
yeah.
it was.
Yeah.
Wasn't there a king, a Portuguese king, who had... Was it Angola?
That's right.
And he pretty much annihilated the population to the point that the rest of the European power said, hold on.
Yeah, you're right about Angola. It wasn't really Angola, it's kind of more Congo. Mm-hmm. Same idea. King Leopold of Belgium. Same idea. But same thing, we're talking about atrocities running into the millions. And if you consider those atrocities took place between 1885 and 1900, the region that we now call Congo has only had 100 years to recover from that kind of culling. And then once that happens, people's culture falls even further. Now, to look at the bigger picture, if we look at Europe during its so-called Dark Ages, from about 500 AD right up until 1100 AD, they weren't saying anything. You follow me? But European scholars are careful not to go there.
Yeah. This is something that we all have to learn, I guess. It's one of those things we have to take very serious, because once you forget about your history, then you're kind of up for grabs, so to speak.
Yeah.
And I kind of feel that's the situation with us as a people on the planet at the moment, where we need to say the 21st century has to be different. We have to reclaim our history, which we also began in the 20th century. And we've had many great African scholars come on the scene. And it's amazing for a people who've been enslaved, who've been degraded, and yet you have such magnificent minds come up and say, you know what, we're going to take a stand and reclaim back our history, and we're going to tell the truth.
Can I answer that?
And you're part of that legacy as well, I do believe, Robin.
But the legacy has to continue to be pushed forward. Here's why. Nigel, you've just come back from Egypt, and you're, if you like, impressed and shocked and angry and moved and empowered and all sorts of different emotions and so on. The reason why I say we have to keep on pushing forward is that in the time of the Honorable Marcus Garvey in the 1920s, he saw the unwrapped mummy of Tutankhamun. What happened was Howard Carter and company discovered the mummy and discovered the artifacts and stupidly toured it around America with the mummy unwrapped. And Pharaoh Tutankhamun looks just like a modern Maasai. And they all saw that. The black Americans all saw that. So we have to ask ourselves, how did the African Americans move from seeing the mummy of Tutankhamun unwrapped
in the 1920s, everybody realizing that he looks just like a Maasai. From that to no history in the 1930s, to no history in the 1940s, to having a rise in consciousness when Minister Malcolm X comes on the scene and starts talking about Suma and starts talking about Timbuktu, and then things drop again, and then things rising again when we get the 70s generation of people like Sheikh Anta Diop, Chancellor Williams, and so forth. You can see that if after Marcus Garvey things dropped, and after Malcolm X things dropped, if we're not careful, things could drop again. And then another generation picks it up and is shocked that, guess what, Tutankhamun was African like us. We have to make sure that things don't drop and it never gets to that situation again. Because if we understand the model of how it works, yeah, we could quite easily lose even this much.
As we've lost so much already. So few then, what should be the purpose of African History Month?
I don't actually agree with African History Month. African history is not just October.
We understand that, but the reality of it is that it's African history is every single day. You know, every day I pick up a book and I read. It's not just one month. For some people, they're not at that stage. They may not even want to get to that stage. They're going to use this month, jump on the bandwagon, and literally jump off again.
Yeah.
So with this month that we do have, what should be the purpose of African History Month?
Education. And it's important that African History Month or Black History Month is not used for food tasting, for fashion shows and nonsense. Nor should it be for people who define themselves as black when it suits them to define themselves as black. And then all of a sudden they're not black anymore, they want a different identity. Black History Month was something that the black community in Britain came up with as something to celebrate us and what we're about. Now, the ideal Black History Month has to have a whole body of courses, whole body of lectures, a whole body of events that flag up different aspects of our history. And those aspects are history in Britain, our history in the Caribbean and Americas, our history in Africa, our ancient history, the black scientists and inventors, the whole nine. And that should be the sorts of things. And there should be things like courses, there should be lectures, there should be storytelling for young people, there should be history competitions in the schools. The whole thing needs to be pushed. And off the backs of Black History Month, courses for adults and young people, and for teachers as well, teacher training should come off the backs of these things, so that eventually Black history gets a more and more secure place everywhere, outside of the education system and inside of it, so that it's being the same ideas are being reflected in different places.
But you've been very instrumental in going up and down the country for several years, putting on black study courses and teaching people about their history.
Indeed, and I think people should watch this space, because there's a course about to start at Kwesi, and again the black studies thing is about to kick off, and yeah, it's a very, very important thing.
Ankhobia with On a Level on New Style Radio 98.7 FM.
As you said, we're here in the 21st century. We've looked at Egypt in some detail. There's still a lot more ground to cover because what we looked at has been quite brief. Is our purpose as black people, as African people on this planet in the 21st century, is it to rebuild who we were? Is it to reclaim our history? What is it that we're trying to do or should be trying to do?
Essentially, if we look at the direction that the world is taking right now, it's quite clear that we're not in the driving seat, we're in the passenger seat at best. And essentially what's happened is that as our power and status has fallen consistently since the year 1600 to where it is right now, if you like, decisions about which direction the world takes are decisions taken without us being present. So you'll end up with things like G8 summits and there's no blacks around the table making any kind of decisions. So essentially we need to get to a situation where we are, if you like, players on the world scene in much the same way that we were in former times.
Coming to the last 30 minutes now of this discussion, I want to take the discussion somewhat back to Egypt. Is there any evidence today, Robin? We talk about the genius of the ancient Egyptians and the things that they did and the philosophies that they created. Is there any evidence today, or even in the 20th century, of us as black people continuing the genius, continuing the legacy of the ancient Egyptians, of ancient African scientists and that kind of thing? Is there any evidence today that we can point to?
What you'll find will be sporadic things, you know, things that you could point to here and there. If we look at, say, scientists and inventors, just going back just over 100 years to somebody like Granville T. Woods. Granville T. Woods was somebody who, an American inventor, who was largely responsible for the electric railway system. I came up from London using essentially technology that he pioneered, and the underground system would not have been possible without his discoveries. And there's lots of examples that you can point to of one examples where that particular scholar did this, that particular scholar did that, but bringing the whole thing together in our interests. Again, a lot of people are very impressed by things like nuclear technology and the fact that you've got black people such as Dr. Lloyd Quarterman, who was one of the pioneers of the atomic bomb, alongside people like Einstein and so forth. Again, and apparently he was one of six African-American scientists that worked on that project. In the areas of space science, you have various people such as Christine Darden, Major Isaac Gillam IV, and so on, who are on the cutting edge of space science technology. These are people that, you know, work for NASA and so on. So the question then is, can we harness these developments in a direction that's positive for our people rather than have these people working for other peoples? And we've not been successful in doing that.
Looking at the legacy of ancient Egypt, what has been Egypt's gift to the world? What kind of legacies has ancient Egypt left for us today?
There's loads and loads of things you can point to. The developments of the various arts, developments of the various sciences, the development of literature, the development of philosophy, and so on. All sorts of things you can point to. If we give some specifics, the funerary complex of Pharaoh Djoser has got columns built into it, the first columns in the world, and that's the basis then of Greek architecture, Roman architecture, Romanesque architecture. We can trace it all the way back to what Pharaoh Djoser and his scholarly prime minister Imhotep constructed. You have things like the Edwin C. Smith surgical papyrus, which has got 48 cases of head and neck surgery indicated on the papyrus. And because it's head and neck surgery, you could even call it brain surgery, if you understand what the areas that it covers. There you have the very first religious texts, the pyramid texts. You also have the very first philosophical texts. There's a document called the Maxims of Ptahhotep, where Ptahhotep is instructing young men who are civil servants in how to conduct themselves in right living. And the ideas in it are so good that I follow them, you know.
You say something about the principles of Maat as well.
That's what it's about. Mm. But there's an even better example of that, where there's an Egyptian story called The Story of the Eloquent Peasant, where he's arguing Maat against powerful people who are trying to exploit him. You have so many other things of Egyptian art, where you've got the modelling of everything from the smallest limestone figurine all the way up to the largest colossus. And the modelling and the proportions are perfect. You have Egyptian art using this notion of canon, where certain things are in certain proportions because they're mathematically correct. You've got examples of Egyptian sciences to do with astronomy, where you have the Egyptians being the first to come up with the 365 and a quarter day year based on the observations of the rising of the star Sirius. So there's so many things that you can point to that the Egyptians left behind.
Maybe the most important, writing.
Absolutely. but that's a bit debatable. Only for one reason, because we're not quite sure whether the Egyptians invented it or the Nubians invented it.
The black.
Well, it's all good. It's all good. And even the discovery of America. Something like that, yeah? I know you're shocked, I know.
Yeah, go on, please explain.
All right, please. Very, very simply, there's a map that was drawn by a Turkish admiral. And the Turkish admiral is called Piri Reis. And Piri Reis was a contemporary of Christopher Columbus. And when Columbus got to America, Piri Reis wrote a book to say that he was a fraud. And the reason why Piri Reis was so convinced that Columbus was a fraud was that in the Islamic world, they'd already had information that blacks had already gone to America, and they named some of them. There's a black sailor called Kashkash ibn Selim ibn Aswad who got there in the 10th century. There's another black that got there in the 14th century called Mansa Abu Bakari II. So in other words, they knew all of this. And the worst charge that Piri Reis levels against Columbus is that Columbus had access to maps that go all the way back to the time of Alexander. Now, if you break down to the time of Alexander, what does he mean? He means the time when the Alexandrians were dominant in Egypt. You follow me?
Yeah.
So essentially, they're Egyptian maps. Now, Piri Reis publishes one of those maps, and he published it in approximately 1513. And a group of scholars in the 20th century went over the map. And they went over the map and they agreed, yes, this goes back to Alexandrian times, so it goes back to 300 BC. They agreed the map comes from Africa. Now the question then is, well, does it belong to the Greeks, because they were in Alexandria, or does it belong to us? And those scholars of, I think it's New Hampshire University, the scholar's name was Professor Charles Hapgood, they worked on the map to try to work out where was the geodetic center of the map. And the center of the map would be, where was the person who drew it? Where was he standing? You follow me? And the geodetic center of the map is the Egyptian-Nubian border. Now, what's on the map? America's on the map. And some of the, even the details of some of the rivers and so forth. You follow me? It's on the map. And so when Piri Reis said that Columbus was a fraud, and here's the proof, that is indeed the proof.
Brothers were kicking it, man. They really had it going on back in the day. But in talking about that, I mean, you know, there's been a great almost move to kind of distort and cover up many aspects of Egyptian history. And the British scholars have had a great role to play in that. Can you talk a little bit about that? What are some of the things that they've actually done?
Yeah, they're frauds. And I've got the evidence too. There's a book by an English scholar, Sir E.A. Wallace Budge, and the book is called Egyptian Statues in the British Museum, published in 1914. In this 1914 book are portraits of pharaohs Sinosret I, Mentuhotep II, Thutmose III, Amenhotep III, Ramesses II, Ramesses VI, and so on. And all of these portraits are kicking butt. All of them show the Egyptians to have your stereotypical broad noses, high cheekbones, thick lips, and so forth. And the only ones that don't have broad noses is because the noses have been smashed in, as is the case with the portrait statue of Sinosret III.
Explain as well, having been to the Egyptian Museum in Cairo, you have a lot of depictions of pharaohs and with their queens, and the queen herself is extremely pale. And
Oh yeah, easy to explain. Yeah, yeah.
Can we explain one first and then get back to that question? Because we're talking about what the British have actually done to distort Egyptian culture and history.
And what's important about the book is that Sir E.A. Wallace Budge was the keeper of Egyptian and Assyrian antiquities. And so he knew the deal. Just looking at those portraits, you realize that he knew the deal. And one of his books is called The Mummy. And there's this bit where he says that the very first Egyptians were black, but then Egypt was overrun by whites. And once they've been overrun by the whites then built the civilization, says Sir Wallace Budge. And he puts a footnote. And then you look at the footnote, and he references a scholar called Amanius Marcellinus, And that scholar is a Roman scholar, and he quotes him in Latin. So having said the Egyptians were Caucasians, he footnotes Amanius Marcellinus in Latin. Now, of course, most people then think, well, you know, it's quoted Latin. What's it saying? You follow me? And the impression given is that the footnote would support the idea that, yes, the Egyptians were Caucasians. I've checked the quote, and Marcellinus, the phrase he uses to describe the Egyptians is atrati and subfusculi. Atrati is the Roman word for ink. In other words, they were ink-coloured. And subfusculi is the Roman word for brown. You follow me? So the Egyptians were between ink-coloured and brown-coloured. And this is what's in the footnote to Sir Wallace Budge's The Mummy. So we have to ask ourselves is, well, why didn't Wallace Budge just come out and say blatantly they were black? You can see what's going on. He's lying.
Yeah.
And his book in 1914 proves that he knows what he was doing. And this particular book, The Mummy, proves that he knows what he was doing. And essentially, once that type of nonsense has worked its way into the system, and you then produce, as I said, sheep, you will then get Egyptologists just parroting stuff that is of no substance. And England has a major hand in this because the British Museum has got some of the best Egyptian artifacts collected in the 19th century all the way up to the time of Sir Wallace Budge and afterwards.
Collected or stolen?
They would presumably say liberated, but I don't think there's any records of any black people getting paid for those artifacts, so yeah.
Nigel, you had a question.
Yeah, just on a similar vein, as Robin was saying, how we have quite a few Europeans who want to distort the importance of black people and pretty much say they weren't black, they were white. Having been to both the British Museum and the Cairo Museum, you have a lot of depictions of pharaohs and their queens. And the pharaoh is depicted with a tan skin, but his wife, his queen, is depicted with very pale or yellow skin. Could Rodden just explain why that's depicted?
Yeah, it's an Egyptian art convention. What's good about Sir Wallace Budge's book, the book I've just mentioned, Egyptian Sculptures in the British Museum, 1914, is that they reproduce one of the very same images that you're talking about. There's a picture of two, it's a man and woman, husband and wife, and they're portrayed the same size. They're sitting down, and the wife's got the arm around the husband, and she's shown as yellow, and he's shown as red. But because this was a black and white photograph, taken in 1914, you can't tell what colours they are. All you can tell is she's light and he's dark. If you look at the faces though, both of them have very, very strong African type faces. Now, what it is not just an Egyptian thing. You also see it in Sudanese art, where men are painted red usually and women are painted yellow usually. And this red and yellow, we know they're not skin colours, because if you look at Pharaoh Tutankhamun, there's images of him painted jet black in some representations, and he's painted red in other representations. It's both him. Similarly, there's a queen called Amos Nefertari, and she is usually shown as black in some images, jet black, I mean proper ink black, and she's shown as yellow in other images, and it's the same Amos Nefertari. So what's going on? They're colour symbols. Now, what they're symbolic of, scholars disagree. Some people say the red represents male fertility associated with the sun, which is Dr. Biko's theory. The yellow represents lunar aspects associated with the moon. Now, where Dr. Biko got that idea from is that you'll sometimes see gods and goddesses with sun disks, where the sun disk, in the case of the male, is red, the sun. In the case of the female, the moon yellow, and that's where the idea comes from.
I only asked the question because obviously one of the tour guides, I don't know where he got his information, he was there saying the reason why the men were darker was because they were out working and got a tan.
Nonsense.
Women were stuck in the house. And that's
yeah, because what they're trying to do is to try and bring Arab culture where the woman becomes a harem. Yeah, it's nonsense. And why it's nonsense is because women worked out in the fields too, and there's such images of that, you can see images of that. Now, what you'll see is, the best example is, you go to the British Museum, you will see little figurines of a whole bunch of people, like the figurines of everybody on a boat. And you can see the men are red and the women are yellow. Now, the red does look close to a skin colour. In other words, you could imagine black people having that colour, but it's still not the real colour. It's still symbols. Red, yellow. Now, extend the analysis. When we look at Greek art now, the Greeks are ancient Europeans. These are white people. You see the men black and the women white. That doesn't mean Greek men are black. It's just the style of the art. You follow me? And it's the same duality concept that they're bringing in. And then when we look at art from Sudan, there's a very famous pyramid called the Pyramid of Queen Kalhata. And in that pyramid, which is in Sudan, men, red, women, yellow. Same thing. Nobody in the Sudan's that color for real. And then when we look at Mbari art in Nigeria, Igbo art, you'll see both men and women red, both men and women yellow. And I recently took a group, in fact, were you in that group? To the British Museum, where I showed a tapestry from ancient Dahomey, which shows the Dahomeyans, the country that we now calls itself Benin, the ancient empire of Dahomey, beating up the people of Yoruba land. And the Dahomeyans are shown as jet black, and the Yorubas are shown as red. But everyone knows Yorubas are black. Same idea.
You're listening to Ankhobia on New Style Radio 98.7.
New Style Radio 98.7 FM. Birmingham's number one community FM.
Wake up! Take the pillow from your head and put a book in it!
That kind of takes me on to the next questions. Did the Egyptians intermarry? The African Egyptians, did they intermarry with not just other African nations, but also with European or Asiatic nations?
Logic would say yes, but the evidence would actually say not at the periods we're talking about, no. Let me explain why I say logic would say yes. After Dynasty 12 collapses, the Middle Kingdom collapses, Egypt is then overrun by Asiatics, who rule as Dynasties 14, 15 and 16. If you look at the amount of time the Asiatics were there, there is no way that the Egyptians could have come out of that pure, because you would have the Asiatics as the ruling class. And then once you've got a ruling class colonizing another group of people, there's going to be abuse going on of the local population, especially the local women. And that abuse is going to produce children. So logic would say that that must have been how it would have happened. But we have from Greek accounts, from the time the Greeks got there, that, and I quote, "Egyptians will not kiss a Greek."
You're talking about a Tom, Dick, and Harry. So now you learn your black history as questions and answers. Every question but the Black Panthers. Timbuktu existed when the caveman existed. Why then isn't this listed? Is it because the black man is the original man? Or does it mean humanity is African?
This is what the Greeks are saying, that the Egyptians... And it was something to do with them being considered unclean. And there's a whole bunch of taboos why the Egyptians would have nothing to do with them. Moreover, when the Greeks moved into Egypt, into this city of Alexandria, they made moves to ban Egyptians from living in the city. So it's fairly obvious that the Egyptians of today are all intermixed. But how far back it goes, logic would say it would go back to the 14th, 15th and 16th dynasties. But the evidence, there is evidence that says that it might not even have happened then because of Egyptian, if you like, prejudices against non-African peoples.
It's interesting you say that, because having gone to Aswan as well, we came across a village, and the guide was telling how the elder of the area, it was custom that they were not allowed to marry anybody who wasn't a Nubian. It wasn't a done thing. It just wouldn't happen. So no matter whether they were both Muslims, the fact that the elder instructed that a woman must marry a Nubian and the male must marry a Nubian woman.
Okay, so there was no jungle fever going on there.
Not at all.
Yeah.
The people that believe in Greek philosophy know your facts. Egypt was a monopoly. Greeks had learned from Egyptian masters. You might say prove it, well here's the answers. 600
640 to 322 BC originates Greek philosophy. But in that era, Greece was at war with themselves and Persia once more. Any philosopher at that time was a criminal. He'd be killed very simple. This indicates that Greece had no respect for science or intellect. So how the hell you created philosophy when you kill philosophers constantly? The point is that we descend from kings, science, art, and beautiful things. African history is the world's history. This is the missing link and mystery. Once we realize that all are African, white will sit there with black and laugh again. So judge not, least ye may be judged. For the judgment ye judge, ye shall be judged. Matthew 7, first verse doesn't budge. No man should walk the earth in sludge. If you don't believe, you can go and check to see how and where the black man's in effect.
But come to the last 10, 15 minutes, two things I want to touch on, which I think are rather important. The first one being Egypt and its depiction in the Bible. And the reason I want to touch on this, you know, I've had friends, for example, who have converted to Islam. They've gone to Egypt, they've brought back the most amazing photographs and images and everything. But when you hear them talk about Egypt, it's painful to listen to. They have no care for it. They think these people were nothing but a bunch of idol worshippers. They were pagan. They didn't create nothing. They didn't do anything. And you listen to the Christians also talk about the Egyptians, a people who they really have no knowledge of other than what they've gleaned in their Bible. But yet they have such hatred and dislike for the Egyptians because they allegedly enslaved the Jews.
Until the lion learns to speak, the tales of hunting will always favor the hunter.
Did the Egyptians, is there any historical data to prove that the Egyptians enslaved the Jews? In other words, are the Christians justified in their view of how they see the Egyptians?
No, there's no evidence for it at all. This is what happens. You're certainly right, I mean, as someone who's been brought up a Christian myself, almost every 2 weeks there'll be a sermon and the pharaohs are going to get beaten up yet again. The truth of the matter is that we've been fooled over this one. And this is what the evidence is. We have essentially the Old Testament. And most of us don't know how the Old Testament was written. Most of us don't know how it was put together. But we believe that it's the Word of God, even though it itself, there's even a line in it where it says, "Beware the lying pen of the scribes." But what happens is that a lot of us didn't do the reading, and we haven't even read the passages concerning the so-called enslavement of the Israelites properly. Now, what it means is that if we're trying to untangle the Israelitish story, to try to work out how much truth there is in it, and you try to pin down when did the Exodus happen, try to pin down who was the Pharaoh who was on the throne at the time of Moses, you can't do it. And the best theory that anyone's ever come up with is the pharaoh on the throne was Ramesses II. But if we follow what the Bible says happens and what the evidence says happens, we know that that didn't happen. Ramesses II was supposed to have been among those who drowned in the Red Sea, but Ramesses II's mummy was discovered in the Valley of the Kings and is on display in the was on display in the Cairo Museum, whichever be the case. I've got a photograph of it and an x-ray of it, and it was not found at the bottom of the Red Sea. The idea that the Israelites crossed the Red Sea and ended up in the Promised Land, not possible, because if you leave Egypt and cross the Red Sea, you end up in Saudi Arabia. You do not end up in the Promised Land. All sorts of things like this where you just realize that we've been fooled. Okay, now, we take a bigger slice of evidence and we then find out what was anybody else saying about the relationship between the ancient Israelites and the ancient Egyptians. And we find out that there was a Jewish scholar of antiquity and his name was Josephus. And Josephus wrote a book called Antiquity of the Jews. And that book is widely read even today. I know that it's one of the books that you'll even get Jewish people being given it as their bar mitzvah present. And in that book, it makes it quite clear that the Hyksos, who ruled Egypt as dynasty 15 and 16, were kindred brothers of the ancient Israelites. That makes the Hyksos Israelites. Now, if the Israelites ruled Egypt as Dynasty 15 and Dynasty 16, then that means that their Old Testament story of being enslaved in Egypt is a lie.
They were the ones who enslaved the Egyptians.
Yeah. Moreover, the Israelites claim that when in Egypt, they were building monuments out of mud, brick, and straw. And we look at the pyramids, and none of the 90 pyramids of Egypt are built of mud, brick, and straw. We then look at the 223 pyramids of the Sudan. None of them are built of mud, brick, and straw. We look at the various temples of Egypt, Karnak, and so forth, and none of them are built of mud, brick, and straw. So, essentially, what's happening is that people are having a laugh at our expense.
Isn't there a passage which makes reference to the Jews actually taking the Egyptians as slaves out of Egypt?
You're right, yeah. If we read Moses' account in the book of Exodus, there's a passage where it says, "Any slave can eat the Passover meal if you have circumcised him first." Now, if we read the context, they're claiming that they're leaving Egypt, fleeing Pharaoh. But who are these slaves that they're carrying? These slaves that they're bringing with them would have to have been ethnic Egyptians. And yes, it does say that, yeah. Any slave may eat the Passover meal if you circumcise him first.
Some people have got to do some serious rereading.
Indeed.
Of that book. Coming up to one of the last points as well. It's the present depiction of Egypt that we have today. When we look at, for example, people talking about the New World Order, and they say it has links to Egypt. They make reference to the third eye as being a symbol of evil. How correct are they in their perceptions of Egypt?
Okay. The scholarship that does this is a type of scholarship coming from America, and it's right-wing Christian scholarship. And there's a publishing house called Huntingdon House who are particularly into that type of stuff. Now, essentially, their belief is that there is, if you like, a conspiracy of people who have come together to undermine Christianity. And these people that have come together to undermine Christianity are people who form societies to push what they see as Satanism. And they believe that the model that some of these groups are taking their thing from is the Egyptian model, where the Egyptians kept knowledge amongst their priesthood and didn't disclose their secrets to the masses. And this idea of keeping knowledge within a group and not disclosing it elsewhere, this is the same model that the right-wing Christians say is being used to rule the world today. And it's then said that this same group had taken symbols from Egypt, such as the pyramid, symbols such as the Eye of Horus and so forth, and are using these symbols in what they consider to be satanic ways. Now, it is possible that the right-wing Christians have a point. And this is why it's possible. Since we know that the Egyptian culture lasted, according to the correct chronology, 5,000 years, according to the short chronology, 2,500 years intact, what people want to know is what made that civilization tick. And what they've done is to study the civilization and to see which bits of it can they use to build their system. You follow me? Now, just because someone has picked an obelisk from Egypt and they're using it in their symbol, their system, picked a pyramid and they're using it in their system, picked the Eye of Horus and they're using it in their system, that doesn't mean that the Egyptians were using it in the same way that they're using it. Now, it doesn't mean the Egyptians weren't, but it doesn't prove that they did. You follow me?
Swastika. Yeah.
Same thing. I mean, a swastika has got very negative connotations right now.
That's from the Hindu.
Yeah, and what's more, there are churches in Ethiopia, the underground church of Mary, which have got swastika-shaped windows. There are artifacts in Igbo land, Western Nigeria. There's a magnificent casting that was found, which has got rounded swastikas on it. So lots of black people are using the swastika, but as a positive energy.
Oh, I'm coming home, Africa, where I belong.
So to finish the point then, just because Europeans today are trying to work conspiracies using some of our symbols to do wickedness, that doesn't mean that's what we were doing back in the day.
Excellent point. One of the things I've heard recently, and particularly coming from some of the younger brothers as well, we had a conversation on the show a few weeks ago where they were talking about spirituality, had some young guys come in. They're talking about spirituality and its relevance today in the inner cities. And they touched upon a lot about Egyptian spirituality and how they wanted to tap into that so that they could then lead their lives. And these are young guys, like 22, 23. But one of the things they said, which I found quite strange, was that the pyramids were built using a system of levitation. And this is something I've heard for quite a few years. And I've always wondered, is this used to kind of say that the Africans didn't have the technologies to create the pyramids? Is this another way of saying that they didn't have the knowledge to create pyramids by saying, oh, this is some mystical thing that went on here. These blocks were levitated into place, all 2.3 million of them.
Yeah, good deduction on your part.
You may write me down in a history with your bitter, twisted lies. You may trod me down in the very dirt, and still like the dust I'll rise.
This is the issue as I understand it. The levitation theory, there is a source that says that. There is one of the ancient writers, I've forgotten which one, who describes it, but I know that the information is in Wayne Chandler's essay in Egypt Revisited, where he discusses this. So someone did say that. So whoever says it now, they didn't make it up. Someone said that. But just because someone said it doesn't mean it's true. Now, what it is that Egyptian technology really does stretch what modern man is capable of. And what it shows is very, very much how far the African race has fallen, if we look at what we used to be able to do. And what it means is that clearly Egyptian technology was very, very highly sophisticated, but the truth is we don't know what it is. And it's in the vacuum of not knowing what it is why people will jump on theories like levitation. But as you rightly say, the levitation theory is simply a way of getting out, a get-out clause, rather than face the fact that African technology was kicking it up.
Well, there's certainly no get-out clause on this show. Coming to the last few minutes, really, of the show. And Robin, I do want to thank you ever so much for taking the time. You've come all the way from London. Taking the time to come and share your knowledge and information with us. It's been great having you on the show, indeed. Hope to have you back in the future.
Thank you very much.
And Nigel, we also want to thank you as well. And I know you're going to be on our shows anyway in the next few weeks to come.
Yep, most definitely.
Just to close off, Robin, we've been talking about Egyptian civilization and culture. For anyone wanting to take this study further, what books would you recommend to them? Where would you tell them to begin their study?
There are the books written by Professor Sheikh Anta Diop. He's written a book called The African Origin of Civilization, Myth or Reality. Then you have the books by Ivan van Sertimer. He's written a book called Egypt Revisited and another book called Egypt, Child of Africa. But if I may be so bold as to also recommend my book, which has taken
the... You can be as bold as you want.
Thank you very much. And there's a book that I've written called When We Ruled.
I love the title. Say it again, please.
When We Ruled. The book is out. There's a website called www.whenweruled.com. And you can buy the book through the website, or you can go into your bookshops. There are some black bookshops in Birmingham, but there's not just that. Go into your bookshops, and you can order the book, and the bookshop will buy it from us, and then you can get the book. Remember the name, it's called When We Ruled.
And how's that book been doing? What's been the public reaction to your work?
I've been very encouraged by the reaction. A lot of people have bought the book, a lot of people are talking about it. And I did a mail out to America, and one of the American professors had told me that they've already been discussing the book on one of their websites, and what they want to be able to do is source the book so they can actually get it in America. So that's been positive, and also New Nation have been very helpful in writing articles about the book and so on.
And it's great that we have Black British scholars like yourself doing the work, getting out there, you're doing the writing. It's not just about us reading books written by African-American scholars, which are also important as well. We're not dealing with division here. But it's nice that there's someone from down the road.
That's right, yeah. And it's essentially, the whole point is to move the argument forward. And it's very, very important that we keep on updating. And that's what the book does. It's very, very much a synthesis and an update of where the argument is. The book's not just on Egypt, it's about African history generally. Because Egypt isn't the only place where we built things. We built things all over Africa. And we built things in the African diaspora as well. And my point then is to bring that forward so that Black people get to know what we're capable of. We get to know what we've achieved, and therefore have a number of models that we can draw upon for inspiration.
Okay, excellent. Like I said, we're going to keep pushing the book as much as possible to get it out there and to let people know. And also, I'd like to say to those listeners who would like to know more about African history, who would like to know more about themselves, past and present, get down to Crazy House, George Street, Lazelle's, this coming October, and learn about your history. Namibia, Egypt, Tunisia, Ethiopia. Say hello to my black skin and shout it loud. I'm proud to be African and black and proud. Many, many years don't pass, but we don't know the truth. Many, many people don't die, but we don't know the truth. We are the children of the chosen one. We never ever bow to Babylon. Myself and Nigel.
Yep. Every Sunday.
We've been very privileged to have Robin as our teacher. An excellent teacher, I must say, the best that I've had. And I really wish I had a teacher like that when I was a young girl in school. It would have made a massive difference. But certainly got me back on track and just kind of firmed me up, so to speak. So thank you, Robin.
Thank you.
Cheers.
Anything you'd like to say, Nigel?
It's the best couple of months I've spent educational-wise. He's not only well-read, well-researched, he's actually quite funny as well.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Quite entertaining young man. So definitely, definitely, if you can make it, come along.
Yeah, well, certainly. Money well spent.
Definitely.
Money well spent. And like I said, it's not just about, you know, because some people think, oh, this is just history, it's done. It's not about that. And that's what I loved about the course, was the continual reflection to where we are now, how you move forward, the solutions that were offered. It was just mind-blowing. What can I say? You've got to get on the course. Don't get left behind.
Mm.
All right. Thank you very much indeed, guys.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
When we ruled.
No topic is out of bounds. If it's real to you, it's uncensored to us. The Honor Level Talk Show. It's real.
When we ruled.
Thank you. Birmingham's number one for African arts, culture, and Afro-edutainment. 98.7 New Style FM.
The On-A-Level Talk Show. It's real.
To get in contact with the On The Level show, it is on-a-level@hotmail.co.uk. on-a-level@hotmail.co.uk.